that this Assembly notes that in June 2016 there were 37,347 households on the social housing waiting list, of which 22,986 were deemed to be in housing stress and 15,474 were deemed to be statutorily homeless, and calls on the Minister for Communities to commit to providing at least 8,800 new-build social housing units and 2,900 affordable housing units over the term of the Programme for Government 2016 to 2021.
Thank you. And I call Nicola Mallon to point of order, Mr. Atwood.
Mr. Speaker, I just want confirmation that when the motion that's now about to be debated was submitted to the business office, the words of the motion refer to the years 2017 to 2021, and that because of the internal procedures of the business office in respect of the names of documents, in this case the Programme for Government 2016 to 2021, the dates were changed in the words that were submitted by the Ulster Unionists and by the SDLP. And in so doing, the business office did not consult with the proposers. And I accept the ruling that you've made in that regard, that because it's been published in that way, so it will be debated in that way. But could you confirm that when the motion was submitted, it was submitted in terms of 2017 to 2021 being the effective dates?
I suppose I do have to sympathise and empathise with the member's frustration in this matter. I do say that it is routine for the business office to correct official titles of documents, as they did in this case, and the correct title of the forthcoming Programme for Government is the Programme for Government 2016-2021. However, for today, it is clearly your intentions, I assume, at this stage, and for the record, that you will refer to during the debate the points that you have already made.
The Speaker for his comments and clarification in that regard. Safe to say that I do think that the business office, if something is not in inverted commas, which is how I would normally refer to an official document of the government, such as the Programme for Government, if it's not in inverted commas, then it should be assumed that the words that are on the words are the words submitted on the motion are the words of the motion.
Well, again, I accept the point that you have made, but let me be very clear. It is the proper procedures were followed by the business office. Let us move on now.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As my colleague has pointed out, on the 4th of October at 11:07, the SDLP submitted the following motion verbatim to the business office, that this Assembly notes that in June 2016 there were 37,347 households on the social housing waiting list, 22,986 deemed to be in housing stress, with 15,474 deemed to be statutorily homeless, and calls for a commitment of at least 8,800 new-build social housing units and 2,900 affordable housing units over the term of the forthcoming 2017 to 2021 Programme for Government. As my colleague has pointed out, this motion, without any consultation with the SDLP or the signatories to this motion, was changed by the business office, substantially altering the intention and the outworkings of this motion. Regrettably, when this error was brought to the Speaker's office's attention, the error that was made by officials has not been corrected, and the motion as it appears in the order paper is not the motion that was submitted by the SDLP, the motion to which I will address my comments. Mr. Speaker, I firmly believe that there are five human rights essential if each of us is to fulfil our potential: the right to food, healthcare, education, work and a home. I have and I will continue to argue that access to a good quality, safe and secure home is the anchor, the glue which holds the other facets of a person's life together. Having access to a good quality, safe and secure home increases multifold your life chances, especially when children are involved. Housing is without doubt an enabler for health and wellbeing. It is key to tackling disadvantage, driving economic growth and job creation, and building a better environment and a more equal, shared and safe society that respects diversity. Housing, Mr Speaker, is both an end and a means. And yet, sadly to date, it hasn't appeared in the draft programme for government as a strategic outcome. By this executive's own figures, as of June this year, as I have pointed out, we have huge numbers of people both on the social housing waiting list and those deemed to be in housing stress, and a staggering and shameful 15,500 people who are deemed to be statutorily homeless. The fact is that thousands upon thousands of our citizens are sitting in poor quality, overcrowded housing not suitable to their needs. Or they are living months and months on end in hostels with their children, or they are sofa surfing at the discretion of friends and families. Meanwhile, their health deteriorates, their educational attainment is challenged, and their economic opportunities are reduced. The truth is, yes, I will.
Would the member care to acquaint the House of what the figure for new builds was when the SDLP held the Department for Social Development?
I thank the member for giving me the opportunity, because when the SDLP held the housing portfolio, we built more houses than any minister prior or any minister since. Mr Speaker, since I was elected to this House, we have debated two housing-related motions. The first was brought in the name of Mr Fran McCann, calling for reform of the common selection scheme, particularly in the area of the award of intimidation points, and the SDLP was fully supportive. The second motion was brought by the Ulster Unionists and ourselves, calling on the Executive to detail its structured and timeline response to the reclassification of our 22 housing associations, a development of profound financial consequence for housing associations' ability to finance and build critically new homes, the focus of this motion before us today, and the wider financial consequences for the executive to carry out its functions with an additional £1 billion added to its balance sheets. Perhaps the Minister today will give us an update on how his negotiations are going with UK Treasury in respect of a derogation and what contingency plans he has in place if legislation is not brought forward within that time frame, and how that might impact on the target of building new social homes. It is right today, Mr Speaker, that we debate the issue which, above all else, is the game changer in terms of tackling our housing crisis. That is the need to make land available and to build new homes. Not a vague indicator, Mr Speaker, to improve the supply of suitable housing, which lacks definition and, as a result of using vague and ambiguous terms such as improve and suitable, leaves this indicator too much open to subjective interpretation. But we need a clear commitment to build a set target of new homes, which contains within that a commitment to build homes for complex needs and older people. This will ease the greatest pressure on the housing system, the shortage of supply, not least in my own constituency of North Belfast. Of course, Mr Speaker, to make this happen, land must be identified and made available. In response to an Assembly question I posed on this issue, the Minister said he had commenced a public land for housing project to identify land suitable for reuse for housing. The SDLP welcomes this initiative, and I would ask the Minister to provide an update to this House today on the progress of that project and what consideration he is giving to the vesting of land and the use of compulsory purchase orders where and when required to tackle the persistent obstacle of land availability to build new homes in real time. We would also invite the Minister today to share with us discussions he is having with local governments to ensure that we maximise the opportunities with the devolution of planning powers and their development of their local area plans, and in particular what plans he has to bring forward the transfer of regeneration powers to really maximise the opportunity that lies within local government. Mr Speaker, the truth is we have thousands of our citizens waiting and waiting on the housing list. We have over 500 disabled households that are waiting and waiting for wheelchair accessible accommodation with no certainty or comfort in sight. These families deserve better. The families living in hostels deserve better, and they deserve more than honeyed words. They need to be given certainty and comfort and a clear commitment to build an ambitious number of new homes each year. In respect of the land supply issue, the Minister will be aware that the Housing Supply Forum brought forward a series of crucial and meaty recommendations. We would invite the Minister today to provide this House with an update on that report. Mr Speaker, the Executive must give clarity in terms of the impact of welfare reform and how it will impact on the many, many social housing tenants. Given that almost half of housing association stock is already at or above the local housing allowance cap, we are also asking the Minister today to share with us his plans to protect those tenants. Undoubtedly, we will face a question across the chamber of how do we plan to pay for all of this? Well, Mr Speaker, we had the money drawn down from the European Investment Bank, which I know the housing associations who are party to that are keen to get moving on. That will allow us to build some 5,000 new social homes. And we also brought to the Minister's attention the potential for Barnett consequentials from the House Build Fund recently announced at the Tory Party conference. We would also invite the Minister to give us an update on that today as well. My colleague will go into detail in respect of the amendments before us, but if I could just make a few comments. In respect of Sinn Féin's amendment, I have to welcome the honesty within their amendment. This is the first time that I am aware that an executive party has been open about its failure to deliver, admitting that since 2007 and 2008, the numbers of people in housing stress has actually gotten worse. But why we welcome the honesty in their amendment? What I cannot understand is why Sinn Féin brought a motion on housing without reference to a single target of at least even one new build housing. That won't bring any comfort to the many people who are sitting struggling and waiting desperately on a new home. It also talks about the executive ensuring that the housing executive has the powers to allow it to build social homes. It has the power, Mr Speaker, in legislation. But again, we have no detail on how they plan to finance that. And I look forward to further detail on that from the party beside me here. If I can now turn very briefly to the DUP motion amendment, it refers to 9,600 new social homes and 3,750 new affordable homes between 2016 and 2021. I am very interested, Mr Speaker, to see where those figures came from, and I would like to know exactly when the Minister made that announcement and how, because as far as I'm aware, it certainly wasn't made in this House, which leads one to suspect that it is in direct response to the motion brought forward by the Opposition today.
Call Mr Frau McCann to move the amendment number one.
Goran Mila Mayogat, Kion Kourla, thank you very much, Mr Speaker. And I raise the support and support of the Sinn Féin amendment to the opposition motion on housing. And I was reading the other day on the Housing Executive homepage that up to 31st of March 2016, there were 37,586 households on social housing waiting lists, of which 22,654 were considered in housing stress. Of these, 12,202 were deemed to be statutory homeless. I was also reading in the Department's housing bulletin, which informed me that in the year ending March 2016, some 18,628 people presented as homeless, and between January and March this year, 4,550 people presented as homeless, a drop of 286 over the same period last year. But these figures also hide a frightening figure, something I've raised time and time again, and that is the figure of those presenting as homeless who are not accepted as homeless, who are mostly young people under the age of 25, many who are advised to go to the private rented sector, and with no mechanism of tracking these people, it is then difficult to understand the journey they are forced to travel. We in this Assembly have a duty to ensure that we do everything within our power to deal with the problem of homelessness. We believe that we constantly need to review how we can develop a strategy which allows us to effectively deal with this difficult and complex matter. Yes, we believe that we constantly need to deliver additional social housing units, and yes, we believe that there needs to be more investment to ensure. Yep, go ahead.
I appreciate the member giving way. The member is absolutely right. We do need to be building more social and affordable housing. I think it's important to put on the record that in the period 2007 to 2011, 9,192 new units were commenced of social and affordable housing. In the period 2011 to 2016, that figure is 12,359. This is in direct contravention to the answer that the lady from North Belfast gave me a few moments ago.
That certainly doesn't surprise me. Thank you for the information, and I'll deal with that as I go on. We believe that there needs to be more investment to ensure that these new social houses can be delivered, but there are also other ways we can tackle waiting lists. One way, again, and it's already been mentioned, is encouraging housing associations to look at new ways of raising the finance to increase their supply. There are those housing associations who have taken that step. They should be commended for their efforts to increase the supply of social housing. Carja, whilst social new builds is seen as the most direct way of providing new, modern, accessible homes, we need to look at other ways in providing much needed housing. Social new build is not the only way housing providers deal with waiting lists. They also rely on the thousands of relets which become available every year. These are people giving up their tenancies and moving on, or people who have died and their home become available for allocation. At the moment, there are roughly, in terms of social housing providers, who have over 130,000 social housing units under their control. This is roughly 88,000 in the hands of the housing executive and 40,000 in the hands of the housing associations. If you consider that there has been lost to this sector over 100,000 houses which were sold under the house sales scheme, and then you think of the impact having these homes still within the sector would have had on waiting lists. We believe that the only way you can protect what is left of the social housing stock is by suspending the house sales scheme. Many of the problems we face in terms of social housing supply can be put down to the constant sale of social houses. Whilst there has been a serious decline in the numbers of houses being sold, any change in that would have serious consequences for the remainder of the social housing stock. Failure to act in this now could see the total collapse of the social housing sector in the years ahead. We should go down the road of the Scottish Assembly, who totally abolished the right to buy in July 2014. Tenants had up to the 31st of July this year to buy their home. The selling of social housing is now a thing of the past in Scotland. An action being taken in Wales by the Welsh Government, who have decided to restrict the house sales scheme by cutting in half the incentive. This in front of legislation which will abolish the scheme altogether in this mandate. We need to follow this example of protecting what is left of our housing stock for future generations. I know many in this House see the house sales scheme as a protected species, but we need to look beyond the perceived popularity of this scheme and grasp the nettle which will ensure that we are willing to go the extra mile in protecting what we have left. The other element of the amendment has been the need to look at how we can bring the housing executive back into the house building arena. It is my understanding that the housing executive retain the power to build, but it is their lack of financial resources which prohibits their ability to build. If we were to find ways to tackle this problem, then we could see the flow of additional social houses into the sector, which would go a long way in dealing with the housing crisis we find ourselves. We need to put a strategy in place which looks at all possibilities. We should rule out nothing. Adapting our amendment will, along with other strategies, move this debate on and send out all the right messages that we are serious about getting to grips with long waiting lists. Sometimes it is easy to get up and continuously quote terrible statistics on homelessness, maybe get a few lines in the press, but when we are speaking about waiting lists, we should remember there are faces behind many of those statistics. There are families in housing stress who know that in their area of choice it will be years before they are considered for a home. There are parents and their children lying in homeless hostels, sometimes for years waiting to be housed. There are young people forced into the private rented sector on the shared room allowance who live their lives in fear because of the conditions and drug abuse which exists in many of these dwellings. And then there are those who suffer from disabilities, who live in social houses which are totally unsuitable for their needs. These are the realities of being homeless. I would encourage this Assembly to throw their weight behind the Sinn Féin motion. I can't understand where the opposition motion came from. Where did they come up with the figures 8,800 new social houses and 2,900 affordable houses? I have always believed that there are those who will opt for an affordable home either through co-ownership or other options which might be an offer. I have also always believed that there is a huge difference in terms of numbers on those waiting lists. for social housing and those on waiting lists for affordable housing. But it never fails to amaze me the selective memories there is, certainly with the SDLP, when it comes to the delivery and development of housing matters. To listen to them, you would believe that the huge waiting lists appeared in recent years, and this was down to Sinn Féin. But the facts tell a different story. I was reading a Department Housing Bulletin, which makes interesting reading. During the reign of the SDLP in the Department of Social Development, 2007-11, and let's take the figures for people presenting as homeless in 2010, which stood at 20,158, and the following year, 19,737 presented as homeless. The figures for 2015-16 was 18,628. I also remember the removal of protections for areas of high demand, such as Derry, West Belfast and North Belfast, by the SDLP's Margaret Ritchie, which has impacted the delivery of social housing. And I further remember the removal of grants for people in terms of renovations, improvement grants and home repairs. This has had a huge impact on the fabric of thousands of people's homes who relied on these grants for urgent repairs. These are fast becoming the slums of the future. Many of the homeowners are in no position to afford essential works, repairs or major works to bring their homes up to a decent standard. That decision by the SDLP Minister has had far-reaching consequences for the less well-off who depended on these grants because of their financial circumstances. And where do many of them end up? On the waiting list, which made homeless in their own home. I remember under her new housing agenda back in 2008, the then Minister, Margaret Ritchie, extended the house sale scheme, which made it easy for people to buy their social homes, thus again putting pressure on the waiting list. So forgive me for being a wee bit cynical when I listen to promises made by the SDLP and the figures they have plucked out of the sky, no, to cobble together a motion for today's debate. And just to finish off, Chair, and we've debate after, it's like the debate last week, we had a motion that they put together from Nathan to come in to give the impression that they're truly concerned and interested about moving the argument, and we have the same thing today. They come with figures that are questionable, as a colleague across the chamber said. I do believe that in our amendment, we offer a good way forward that will allow us to tap into the more social houses and the retention of the social housing stock in the future. Thank you very much and support amendment.
Call Mr. Jonathan Bell to move amendment number 2. Mr. Bell.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I rise to propose amendment number 2. Should declare an interest in that I spent the formative years of my life with two wonderful parents in social housing accommodation. I believe passionately in the need for social housing. I believe that if devolution is to mean anything, it is to mean that we have to do more and better, particularly to those most in need. And it's more in sorrow than in anger that I propose this amendment, given the abject inadequacy of the SDLP and Ulster Unionist motion, which was selling short people in social housing.
Absolutely.
It was selling them short. And the reason this amendment is coming forward today is because we have to do better. And this party and this amendment is not prepared to follow the SDLP and Ulster Unionist line of continuing to sell short the people that are most in need for social housing. I mean, if opposition, and I support that, I thought we were going to get something that was going to be challenging. I thought we were going to get something that was going to be invigorating. Instead, what we've got is an amalgamation of the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP to actually sell short hundreds of people on the social housing list, and yet they purport to believe or say that they are their priority. Well, we're not prepared to sell those people short. I think we understand the need that there is. 37,347 people on a social housing list, 22,986 in housing stress, 15,474 statutory homeless. Now, even by the figure that they've given this morning of 8,800, still inadequate, still not good enough. And I think the message coming from people in social housing need is the opposition needs to get their act together and do better for them. And when I look at the vision of the... forgive me, but I'm actually going to stand up for people in social housing need, not sell them short. When I look at the vision that people are in...
Somebody who cannot get up and stand up, I take utter offence to those remarks, and I would ask you to take them back.
The point I was making is I am standing up, as you well know, for the people in social housing need. That was the only meaning I had in that. And I will continue to stand up for people in social housing need. And you'll hear when I come on that part of the proposal and part of the, what I want to see is more wheelchair-accessible social housing coming from a family with significant disability within it, family who are wheelchair-bound. We are not doing enough in social housing. And neither the Ulster Unionist motion or the SDLP motion does enough for disabled people. It sells them short. Now, can I move on? Let me point out the inadequacies first. To bring forward a pathetic motion that they have done, selling short by hundreds of people the need, speaks to me of people that want to talk the talk. Well, this government, this executive, is prepared to walk the walk. And when I look back at the record of what there was, and I had the privilege of serving 5 years in that executive, where we set ourselves a target of 7,500 new social housing units, we delivered 7,669. When we looked at what was achieved in terms of both new units and affordability of 2,450, and we achieved 4,700. Can I suggest to you, that is the reason the people of Northern Ireland give us the mandate to govern them, because not only could we set a target, but we could over-deliver on that target. Now, having got that mandate from the people, the last thing we are going to do, and the last thing we're going to allow, is the people that are most in need in this society to be sold short by a so-called opposition, whose self-appointed senior leader and self-appointed, I presume by definition, junior leader, isn't even bothered to turn up. So they're not prepared to do that. Now let me move on to what we need to do. We need a delivery strategy. We have got a First Minister that is focused upon delivery. We've got a Minister that has got a comprehensive vision, not to do just what the audit tells him to do. And by the audit, I'm referring to the net stock of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive. And that audit, welcome to your opposition, that audit of some 8,000 people that were needed, and they come. The Minister comes to the House, not just with what the audit of need is, but with some 1,600 houses in excess of that audit by 2021. Now, I noticed the, and I feel embarrassed for the proposer when she tried to defend the SDLP record of 07 to 11. Because if you take those 4 years and the subsequent 5 years when our party had control, there were hundreds of new homes built year after year from these benches than were done for those benches. And what do? They come today with another record of failure and inadequacy. It's time for ambition. It's time for us to seize the day. It's time for us to look at how we can access money and encourage the Minister, if we have housing associations that can build two houses with the different facilities that they have, compared to the housing executive who on a basis can only build one house, surely we should be focusing the energy on the housing associations, their capacity to borrow, and the ability to build two houses rather than focus on where there could only be one. That's only one aspect. We've got to look at finance, and there is no unlimited supply of money. We've got to look at where land is available. We've got to look at the area of co-ownership and against targets of hundreds, we have achieved in the past targets of thousands. We also, Minister, have got to look towards how we can provide people who are most in need with the best advice possible, tailored to their needs and a person-centred approach to their families. And I welcome and encourage the Minister to continue to put money into the Housing Advice Service, because I believe, and I've found it numerous times in my constituency, that when the right advice is got early on, significant problems, including homelessness, and I know one report looks at up to 500 people could be saved from homelessness with just the right amount of advice. So yes, people will say, why are you paying for advice? We're paying for advice because we believe that prevention is better than cure. Housing, Mr. Speaker, is fundamental to shaping the needs of our society. The Minister needs to keep his mind open. And thankfully, we have a Minister with an open mind that's not just prepared to accept an audited target, but is prepared to look at possibilities and also see what can be done and exceed that 8,000 target by 1,600 in this mandate by 2021. That's the measure that we're going to go by. We're going to go by delivery. We're not going to accept the failed policies of the SDLP evidence from 2007 to 2011, where hundreds of people, compared to the next number of years, were deprived of adequate need. We're not going to accept the lack of vision, the poverty of ambition of an Ulster Unionist Party and an SDLP joining together to deliver less than what the government is going to deliver to them. We want more. We want better. And the challenge to all of us around the House is to unite behind this amendment, because it is in this amendment that we deliver the 9,600 new social homes. It's in this amendment that we deliver the 3,750 affordable homes. I encourage the House to get behind this amendment.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
By so doing, I will do, Mr. Speaker. By being behind this amendment, we will deliver more and better, and don't accept the second best of what's purporting to be an opposition.
Call Mr. Andy Allen.
Mr. Speaker, and I too, like the previous member, declare an interest as an individual who was raised in social housing. So I will not take any lectures from him, or indeed any other member around this House, into the needs of those in social housing. And indeed, I will not take lectures around championing the needs of those with disabilities, because I think I full well understand the needs of those with disabilities. So I'll not sit here and take any lectures. Thank you very much. Mr. Speaker, the problem with housing, we have four questions we need to ask. What is the problem? What is the solution? What is the existing legislation and the proposed changes? As we've heard around the House already, we know full well the problem. The problem is we have 37,347 individuals on the housing waiting list, of which 22,986 were deemed to be in housing stress and 15,474 were deemed to be statutory homeless. And as the previous member from Sinn Féin pointed out, yes, there are statistics, and I will take no lectures either as to the reality of those statistics. I don't quote those statistics loosely, because I see day and daily, like the member and like other members around this House, individuals who cannot access social housing or indeed affordable housing. And we as in this House need to do all we can to give them the opportunity to access that. In 2013, homeless charity Crisis carried out a research which identified Northern Ireland had a higher rate of homelessness than any other region of the UK. Indeed, the SDLP member and my opposition colleague pointed out there's five basic human rights, and indeed housing is fundamental to that. It is well established, for example, that housing is one of the biggest detriments of the health of any population. In fact, recent research by NIHE identified a potential annual saving to NHS in Northern Ireland of £33 million if targeted improvements were made to housing. Additional research pointed to the cost of homelessness to the NHS as being between £24,000 and £30,000 per annum per individual. Prioritising
The prevention of homelessness and the improvement of homes, therefore, has cascading and multiple impact on our health and public purse. Indeed, this is an issue I firmly believe we need to see cross-departmental working. We need to see all the ministers stepping up to the plate. And indeed, as my party leader pointed out, when we had the programme for government discussions, we should have been around that table and housing should have been put on the whiteboard. And we should have been discussing and how we are going to collectively approach the housing crisis that we're embarking upon. Yes.
Does the member not find it interesting that Sinn Féin lectures the SDLP about its shortcomings when it took the housing portfolio, but in 9 years refused to take it because it clearly doesn't deem it important enough? And once again, when we debate the critically important issue of housing, the DUP spends most of its time not addressing the substantive issues, but attacking opposition.
The member has an extra minute.
I thank the member for intervention, and I think we'll find across this House the Executive Party's critique for the sake of critiquing, but we never see delivery. And when we start seeing delivery, then we'll work constructively with them. Does the member want to come in?
Yes, I do. Happy to come in. The member makes the point about people should have been round the table having discussions. His little lecture would be more believable were it not for the fact that his party could have been round the table and opted instead for irrelevance in opposition.
The member knows full well we were round that table and we would have continued to be around that table if him and his executive colleagues weren't escaping off to the castle for their secret talks. I will.
Member for Given Way, does he not think that it is a ridiculous way for the member for South Belfast to demean his own colleagues in Westminster by suggesting that opposition is merely an irrelevance?
I thank the member for that valid point. And I sat here not so... I thank the member for a very valid point, and I think I sat here not so long ago listening to a member on the DUP benches critiquing the opposition for the way in which we behaved. Yeah, okay. Thanks very much for that. In short, Mr. Speaker, we need to build more homes. We therefore, and I will reiterate and point out, it is disappointing that our original motion was changed, and I take on board the rationale and the reason for that, but we should have been consulted. In short, our motion calls for the Minister for Communities to commit to prioritise at least 8,800 new builds. That is more than what the DUP motion, because ours is 4, not 5, remember. We have moved to an outcomes-based PFG, and the reality that we've moved to that outcome-based is reality that the previous government was not working. We've had 9 years of the DUP and Sinn Féin not delivering for our people. I'm quite happy to sit here that we're not totally faultless, and we're quite happy to sit and indeed say that we stand up and we take the criticism, but we're here and we're prepared to deliver. Instead of putting things forward and stand here when it was made quite clear in the chamber that our motion refers to a 4-year period and then members tried to put that down.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Just in conclusion, Mr. Speaker, we do not support the Sinn Féin motion as we do not believe the suspension of the housing sales scheme. We believe we would be supportive of a review.
Member's time is up.
Forward. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mrs. Naomi Long.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And on behalf of the Alliance Party, I want to welcome the opportunity to speak on the motion and the amendments. Social housing is an absolutely crucial part of our infrastructure and is a key public service. In my own constituency in East Belfast, I've seen firsthand the impact that housing stress and homelessness have on individuals and families in terms of their health and wellbeing, and I'm content to support today's motion. Already, challenges facing the private housing, housing sector, reform of the common selection scheme and the recent reclassification of housing associations have all been debated in this chamber, which I think reflects the fact that housing is important to everyone in the chamber. And despite what has happened here this morning in terms of the nature of the exchanges, I think it would be more reflective of the concerns of people outside if we focused on the core issues. Mr. Speaker, today's motion highlights the global picture in terms of housing need. However, my own constituency in East Belfast, there were over 1,000 applicants facing housing stress and 555 people registered as homeless. Behind each of those statistics are individuals who are living in entirely unsuitable accommodation for their needs, who are in overcrowded homes, who are living from day to day, sofa surfing, in hostels, and in a number of cases that I have dealt with, sleeping in cars. This is a failure to protect human dignity, and I think for two reasons it is an issue that the Executive needs to approach with urgency. Firstly, the Northern Ireland Research and Statistics Agency has documented that the population here is due to rise to 2 million by 2034, therefore increasing the pressure on housing. Secondly, given the financial uncertainty facing the sector due to the recent decision by ONS, I think that there is an uncertainty in that sector about how they will be able to continue to do the work which they have done in terms of contributing to new builds. Oh, well, yes.
Thank the member for giving way, and perhaps, as my colleague in the SDLP has alluded to, perhaps the minister can give us some feedback as to the discussions on Friday that the officials were at.
Well, I would certainly be welcoming of any update that the minister could.
The member
provide.
Has an extra minute.
Thank you. I certainly would be welcome of any update that the minister could provide to us, because it is important that that financial flexibility that housing associations has is deployed in order to address housing need. The Minister has informed the Committee and this House of his intention already to build 1,600 homes next year using the $106 million that was allocated by the Social Housing Development Programme. It was noted during his initial meeting with the Committee that that figure was less than 2,000 recommended by the Housing Executive. However, Alliance are happy to support today's amendment from the DUP, despite your best efforts to try to dissuade us from doing so, because actually it is an increase in the ambition that they're showing for social housing. If it's prompted by an opposition motion, then congratulations to the opposition for drawing that out. I think it's disingenuous for some to suggest that these figures were in the public domain prior to this debate, and so I think it is credit to those in opposition who have drawn this out into public discussion and seen that increase in ambition, and it's something that we welcome. Unfortunately, the Sinn Féin amendment we will not be supporting, because it is a broad brush approach to what is, I think, a very difficult issue. In some localities, it would be helpful as a short-term measure to protect housing stock. However, it ignores the contribution which Right to Buy has had in terms of stabilising neighbourhoods and helping people to access a foot on the housing ladder. I don't believe that the housing sector either is clear that the policy is the issue, but rather how it is applied. So instead of suspension of the scheme, I think consideration could be given to, for example, a reduction in the discount available to tenants, ensuring that the debt burden of new build is cleared before houses are sold, alongside a commitment that every home purchased will result in another being built and that money being reinvested in housing stock. So we don't support that amendment. Mr Speaker, to tackle... I will, yes.
Does she not appreciate, though, that continually selling off of the home and having to reinvest, given that they're sold at less than market value, means that we're forever having to further subsidise, much more so than if we didn't have the house sales scheme?
Well, yes, we do have to subsidise, but I think the house sales scheme is good in terms of building viable, sustainable communities that are vibrant. I think it is important that people are able to get a foot on the housing ladder in the communities in which they've grown up and be able to contribute back into those communities. So I don't think that a broad brush approach of stopping the housing sales scheme is actually the way forward. In terms of what I'm going to say next, that will become clear. Mr Speaker, to tackle the housing crisis that we're in, Alliance believes that there are a number of things we can do in terms of how we approach housing. First of all, there are 20,000 vacant properties dormant across Northern Ireland. A focus on returning them to use would not only add to the housing stock, but would reinvigorate communities often who find dereliction a real challenge in terms of antisocial behaviour and other problems. A scheme to deal with that would be very welcome. Secondly, to create viable and sustainable and thriving communities, we believe that expanding the emphasis on development of mixed tenure housing is hugely important, so that people in social housing are not stigmatised, not cut off from the services that others can enjoy, and are able to actually progress in society and be encouraged to do so because of the mix of tenure in that area. Finally, Mr Speaker, I think we need to look at the barriers to people being able to accept housing in which they feel safe. in their homes. Intimidation, whether it is sectarian or whether it is within communities, continues to render people homeless. And we need to actually deal with shared housing in order to allow people to have more choice, not less.
Ask the member to conclude her remark.
I will, Mr. Speaker. I was disappointed, I have to say, in the Minister's response that this was social engineering. Quite the opposite. This is about maximising the choice
Members,
so that any person
Members,
can live in
up.
Any home in any place.
Call Mrs. Michelle Gildernew.
And Corla. I'm delighted to be able to participate in this debate today. To a certain extent, I do agree with Nicola Mallon in her opening remarks. Housing is a fundamental human right. Indeed, the issue of housing or lack thereof is the reason for my own involvement in politics. Indeed, the Housing Executive was set up after the eviction in Caledon in 1968 and has worked to deliver the building and allocation of social housing for almost 50 years. However, in the SDLP's PFG submissions, where they produced six theme documents on poverty, infrastructure, justice, economy, health and childcare, social housing isn't mentioned. They make no mention of housing need or provision in rural areas. And again, housing in rural areas has always been of great interest to me. I'm on record numerous times over my time in this Assembly, in this Chamber and in the Social Development Committee in talking about the level of unfitness, particularly in my own constituency in Fermanagh South Tyrone. And I was horrified when the then SDLP Minister removed the Housing Executive Maintenance Grant Scheme when she then condemned rural dwellers, many of them, to live in accommodation, some of which was not fit for purpose. So I was aghast to hear that a scheme that was helping to bring houses up to a level of fitness in my constituency, that scheme was done away with. And then, around the same time, other changes in the allocation of the housing budget were to have unprecedented implications for the housing stock. House sales, for example, 2,201 house sales were completed during 2006-07. Yet in 2008, Margaret Ritchie chose to extend the house sale scheme. When then further to that, she announced that she was providing funding for the purchase of off-the-shelves homes for private developers. Under this scheme, Clanmill Housing Association bought 40 private apartments valued in the region of $7 million, which meant an approximate cost of $175,000 per property. So who benefited from that? The developers certainly, and also the tenants. But was it the best use of public funding?
Member appreciate as well, I recall for many, many years the people in the village area have been fighting to get redevelopment and proper housing. At a time when the SDLP minister was in place, people in the village were told there was no funding for that. The same minister was able to find funding to keep a big wheel at the side of the City Hall.
The member has an extra minute.
Okay, thank you. Well, I'm not sure of that. And I did actually see, in fairness to the minister, references to the village and to her commitment to trying to bring the housing stock up in the village while preparing for this debate. So, but I think, to my point of view, I think the difficulty with buying off-the-shelf houses meant that, yes, some tenants in Belfast benefited from it, but there was a decimation in the budget which had a knock-on effect across the region. And it meant, in real terms, that housing associations had been given more than $130 million in taxpayers' money to purchase 1,400 homes and private developments to be turned into social housing. The collapse then in the property market meant that the average cost of an off-the-shelf home in 2011 dropped to just £60,000, less than half of the original price 4 years previously. So a very poor investment in monetary terms coming from the public purse. Take that along with the extension of the house sales scheme, I found that there was a knock-on effect across the board and that there was much less in the way of social housing available to constituencies like my own. So the decimated housing executive stock, which now stands at around 88,000, I understand, means that we do have a knock-on and there isn't enough social housing for many of the people who need it most. I'd also like, before I run out of time, Cian Corla, to talk about the 70% of adults with a learning disability who currently live at home with carers. And that needs to be properly assessed. And I would ask the Minister to extrapolate the figures from the different trusts and to bring in the need that's there currently, the need of people not just with a physical disability, of which there are many, but those with a learning disability need to be factored into our waiting list to ensure that we do have a proper grasp of the need that's out there and then find ways to meet that need and to provide quality, affordable social homes for people right across the board. Gormila Myogov.
Call Mr George Robinson.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Mr Speaker, this debate refers to one of the most pressing problems that many people experience today, that of finding social housing which is suitable for their needs and at a price they can afford. The motion states that a further 2,900 affordable housing units are desirable. I would ask the member who signed to read the DUP 2016 manifesto, where it states that my party want to see 8,000 affordable homes delivered in the programme for government period to 2020. That is 5,100 more than the motion states. I feel sure those who propose the motion will be relieved to learn that. When it comes to new build properties, there is no doubt this is an important way to achieve, you had your say, to achieve what the motion seeks. It is an important way of dealing with the 37,000 households awaiting homes. However, I wonder if those who moved the motion have had discussions with the Finance Minister regarding the funding of these new build homes. It is an unpleasant reality that all plans need to be funded, and the financial cake we have in Northern Ireland is already divided thinly. I would like to point out that in the previous mandate, 2011-2015, that $400 million of public sector money was spent along with $315 million of private sector funding, resulting in over 8,500 social and affordable homes being constructed during the period, and in my opinion, a respectable record. Mr Speaker, I also believe that we have to look at bringing empty properties back into use. In my own town, I saw quite a few void properties repaired and returned to use, and the great appreciation from the families who were awarded them. I look at that and understand the value of that approach. I also believe there is merit in looking at developing empty space above commercial premises. I appreciate that people moved out of our town and city centres due to the troubles, but now that the bombings and firebombings have ceased, the time is right to utilise empty domestic properties in the centres of towns and cities. Finally, Mr Speaker, there is a need for social and affordable housing, but to solve the current situation, we must look at all possible solutions. We must ensure what finances is available and is used in the best way to reduce the level of families needing a home. I therefore cannot support the motion. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Call Mr Gordon Dunn.
Mr Speaker, and I too welcome the opportunity to speak in support of the Amendment No. 2 here today. There is no doubt that there are real challenges that do continue to exist as we try to meet the housing needs of our population. Our growing population, which is projected to reach 2 million by 2034, and 1.9 million within the next 5 years' time, does reinforce the need to continue to plan and build in a measured and strategic way to ensure the housing needs of our communities are met. I welcome the Minister's recent commitment to housing when he increased the budget for the Social Housing Development Programme with the aim of creating 1,600 new starts this year. Every day within my constituency office, housing continues to be a major issue for many people, including young people seeking their first home, right through to the elderly person seeking suitable ground floor accommodation within a sheltered housing scheme, if available. Demand continues to grow as housing executive stock continues to diminish as they are sold off to tenants, which has given many people a great opportunity to get their first home. There has been a real transformation in so many estates right through Northern Ireland, with the investment that has gone in through the department and the former DSD department. And I think we should commend all the good work that has been done through the housing associations and the housing executives, that they've continued to transform many estates working with the local communities. I know locally within my own constituency in North Down, and I can think of areas like Kilcooley and Bangor, one of the largest estates in Northern Ireland, Whitehill and Bloomfield, Rathgill also in Bangor, indeed West Green and Hollywood, have all benefited from major investment which has helped to transform these areas. I recently had the pleasure of joining with the Minister in Rathgill to see exciting new fold housing development opened. This scheme, which has had considerable community consultation between Fold and the local Rathgill Community Association, is very much in progress and will add to the housing stock within that area. Many new purpose-built quality homes have been constructed to meet the needs of many our young people, elderly and those with disabilities, and I know how grateful many new tenants are who are living within these new properties. As of June 2016, there were 2,045 on the waiting list within North Down. 810 of these were classed as homeless. So this shows there's more needs to be done. However, we must continue to build on the progress which has already been made done to date. Now, co-ownership also is a great way to give young people an opportunity to own their first home. And I would commend the efforts of the Minister in this, and it's so important as young people try to find and meet the challenge to get on the property ladder, with property prices still being excessive. We need to see investment in the supply of affordable homes for our young people. A lot of good work continues to be done, and I put on record our thanks to the Housing Executive in the Bangor office, who we work with on a very regular basis. The constructive work that they have done and continues on in helping to meet the housing needs of the local people. More could be done to acquire land in areas of high demand like North Down through cooperation with our local councils and other government agencies in relation to surplus land. I support Amendment 2, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mr. Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have a habit, and I think it's probably a good habit, of wishing ministers, especially ministers of welfare and housing, well. And I do wish this minister well, because my memory as housing minister is that that's one of the most valuable pieces of work you can do in government. I met the Minister of Education coming down here this morning, and he said that he had a whole series of school visits planned. And I think that was telling the tale, that going to schools or going to new build housing or announcing housing plans is part of the best of work of any minister. And I would wish him well in all of that. But I do think, and I wasn't planning to do this, I do think I have to comment upon some of the earlier debate by making two remarks, both in respect to the figures of new build and in respect of waiting lists. There was a sense of this debate this morning that it was play your cards right. Higher, higher, higher seemed to be the claim of some. So in order to get clarity, to break through the fog, let's look at what a DUP minister said in reply to a question in this House about new build social housing, going back to 1998. And I will lodge this answer to this question in the library. And I hope this minister, coming from the same party as his predecessor, Nelson McCausland, will not dispute the figures of the previous minister, Nelson McCausland, and that nobody in this chamber will dispute the figures of the previous minister. And what did those figures confirm? That in the years 2007 to 2010-11, when the SDLP had the housing brief, there was 8,394 new build housing social starts. That is, new build, off the shelf, existing satisfactory purchases and rehab and re-improvement. That is Nelson McCausland speaking. But then Nelson McCausland went further and he said, in the 4 years from 2011 to 2015, what was the comparable figure? 6,704. So the facts from the DUP confirm that in the 4 years when we were in the ministry and compared to the 4 years since, or the 8 years before we were in the ministry, new build social housing starts were at their height of any mandate of any government that had responsibility for this area. I hope that settles the issue about the facts. I will in a second. And I want to turn to what Mr. McCann said, because he gave us a further facts about what housing waiting stress and housing stress was in previous times. But the one thing that he didn't dispute were the figures in the SDLP motion, the figures that refer to 37,000 and more on social housing waiting, 22,000 and more in housing stress, and 15,000 and more deemed to be statutorily homeless. He didn't dispute those figures, and those figures are the most acute in a generation. And therefore, whatever the figures were when the SDLP was in government, the figures are far worse and are deepening as we speak. So those two facts of the achievement in government and the rate and the size of lists now should once and for all conclude the argument about facts.
The member give way.
I will.
There was also reference earlier from Sinn Féin that there was nothing in the programme for government negotiations from the SDLP. In our submission, did we not propose three bills relating to housing and also have an entire section of our document relating to housing?
So I don't know where Michelle Gillenou gets her information. Probably where John O'Dowd gets his information. Because yesterday he didn't know what Martin McGuinness had said the previous day, and today Michelle Gillenou doesn't know what we submitted to the PFG, where, and I wrote part of this, we set challenging targets. I'm sure the Minister's aware, in respect of new build and affordable housing. I hope that Michelle Gillenou will reflect upon all of that. But I want to move in the conclusion to ask a number of critical questions in a minute. Because if the Minister can answer these questions in a positive way, if not today, then subsequently, then the new targets that are being achieved, that are being outlined in the DUP motion might be met. And I welcome those new targets. And you know the curious thing about those new targets? Pro rata, they're virtually identical to the SDLP amendment. The figures that we propose over 4 years, pro rata, are identical to the figures that the Minister proposes over five. I think opposition has proven its worth today because it smoked out the DUP, without reference, of course, to their colleagues in government, smoked the DUP out to the point that they had to put hard figures on the public record in response to hard figures being proposed by the opposition. I'll write to the Minister in respect of a series of 12 questions I have, and I look forward to the Minister's response because in that way, the figures and the operation and implementation can deliver to address the stress and waiting lists that we have in our motion.
Thank you. I call Mr. Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I had absolutely no idea you were going to call me, but thank you very much. I didn't assume I'd be called straight after Mr. Atwood. I'd like to, first of all, welcome the fact that this is the first day in which we have had joint motions from the opposition. I think when we hear the cries from across the room that the opposition can't get their act together, we have today got at least two motions with joint names on them from the Ulster Unionist Party and the SDLP. I'm also very glad as Mr. Yes.
Would the member agree that this debate highlights the division between the two main executive parties, in that we have a Sinn Féin motion castigating house sales, which patently the DUP is not going to accept. So insofar as this debate highlights division, isn't it a chasm at the centre of this executive on housing policy?
Member, isn't it?
Well, I thank the member very much for his intervention. He must have seen some of the notes that I have in front of me, because it is absolutely clear, given the criticism that comes from the other side of the room, and sometimes from this side of the room as well, that, God, the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP don't agree on every single aspect of policy, and why would we? God, the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP have a slightly different approach to the European Union, and why wouldn't we? Oh, my God, the SDLP... Oh, my God, the SDLP and the Ulster Unionists don't have the same manifestos. Why would we? But I'll tell you what we do do. We work together in the interests of democracy and in the interests of this House. That's why I believe very, very strongly that the opposition is having an impact. And as Mr. Attwood pointed out, we have seen new figures from the Minister, and we very much welcome the new figures from the Minister, because the new figures from the Minister, the new commitment from the Minister, the new understanding that we need to build more social housing and more affordable housing to a level that is appropriate, a level that is required, says that the opposition is working, that the opposition is pushing the executive to do more and better things. Because when we went into opposition, we didn't say that we were just going to oppose everything for opposition's sake. In fact, we said the exact opposite. We said we'd work with the Ulster Unionists, we'd work with any political party, either in government or outside of government, to make sure that the executive do the best possible things for the people who need it most. It is strange. Maybe it's deliberate. I'm not sure, Mr. Alistair. But we have seen a real attempt in radio studios and TV studios and in this chamber, and I'm glad to see it, to see the two government parties working together. Unfortunately, today, somebody didn't get the memo. It is strange. It looks a bit like the last mandate. Maybe they have slipped up. Maybe we're going to see more of this to come. But we have two opposing amendments from the two government parties. Yes, go ahead.
Well, the member note with interest, every time we refer to the previous mandate, those on the opposite benches continually refer to the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP being in that government. But they now no longer have that cover to blame the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP for the failure, and they'll be found out for what exactly they are.
Well, I thank the member very much for his intervention. Yes, of course we were in the last government. The SDLP had one member of that government, and for all the talk of the collegiate partnership working that we now hear, there wasn't much of that. When we were in government, I can tell you very, very clearly, Mr. Deputy Speaker, there wasn't much of that. There wasn't much respect for our mandate or the Ulster Unionist mandate or the Alliance Party mandate around that particular executive table. And if things have changed, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I welcome that. I believe, Mr. Stalford and Mr. Deputy Speaker, that it is the fact of an opposition that is forcing this government to work together. And we'll see. When it comes to the final production of the programme for government, is it just going to be about bluer skies and greener grass? Or are we going to see some real commitments to the people? People in my constituency, people in West Belfast, people in North Belfast, people right across the north of Ireland who've been let down by 9 successive years of bad government. Hopefully the opposition is going to put those guys and these guys in their place and get them finally delivering for the people of Northern Ireland, and make sure that people my age and people of my generation don't have to leave our shores to find work or a university place. Hopefully it is the opposition that is putting the government in the right place once and for all, and we welcome the move from the Minister to take our consideration and our proposals on board to change the desperately needed situation that we need to build more social housing for our people. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr. Stephen Agnew. Mr. Agnew, you have 5 minutes if you choose to take it, but an intervention will not give you an extra minute.
Okay. Thank you for that, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I had thought we'd moved to the era of outcomes. Unfortunately, this debate has very much been about outputs, arguing over numbers, who built more houses than whom, when the reality is that whether it was the last 5 years with the DUP in position, holding the ministerial position, or the 4 years previously with the SDLP, effectively there has been little change in terms of housing need, housing stress and homelessness. There may have been some variation, but around a minor scale. What we have done effectively is keep a lid on the problem, but we haven't got to the point where we've been able to address it or are able to tackle it. And it's not just about those two parties. We have had five parties in government, and Sinn Féin can criticise, but they've been the second largest party in government for a considerable amount of time. And I think there needs to be collective responsibility, but also collective action in seeking to address it. I don't make those points to criticise the record of any party, but just to criticise the tone of the debate, which I don't think has been particularly constructive. Because sometimes it's important in politics we disagree. Absolutely, that's what politics is about. But we actually don't disagree in this issue. We don't disagree that our levels of housing stress and homelessness are too high. We agree that we need to build more housing. We might disagree marginally around the issue of house sales scheme, and I will come to that. But on the majority of the issues, we agree, yet to listen to the tone of a debate, we're in complete odds, and there's almost an accusation that some parties support homelessness. It's a wonderful thing, and we should have more of it. Nobody subscribes to that view. We all want to do an issue, tackle the issue, and we should work together to do so. In terms of the different approaches laid out in the motion and the two amendments, I accept that what the SDLP say and how we arrived at the figures that are in the motion, but also I think that's what we're voting on. So in that regard, I'd be inclined to support the Sinn Féin amendment, because I think it does talk about going beyond what we're currently doing and do some things different. It is my view we should be suspending the house sales scheme. We have seen, whilst house sales are modest at the minute, if we do see a boom in the housing market again, we will see the undercutting of our investment in public housing. And we've seen, for example, if we look at this over decades, the effect of the house sales scheme, 155,000 social or housing executive houses in 1973, down to 88,000 today. And that, whilst we can look over the last few years where we have been building more than we've been selling, over the course of the right to buy scheme, as it's commonly known, we're selling off more than we're building, and that can't continue, and I think it's right that we suspend that. I think it is also right that we do look at options for allowing the housing executive to finance new builds again. And the call goes out, I think, rightly, what have you done? Well, I have commissioned research as to what those options should be. And once that research is complete and I've had time to look at it, I will come back with my proposals as to how that should happen. But right now I want to support that principle to give the housing executive power back. Because we have had talk, there's been this call, and I think I'm right in saying the minister, to be fair, as opposed to it, of convergence in rents between housing executive and housing associations. I think the reality that the housing executive would be able to borrow at cheaper rates given its 88,000 housing assets, I think that's something that can help mitigate that argument and help us resist any drive to increase social housing rents within the housing executive and allow the housing executive to raise finance in other ways without putting an added burden on those already on some of the lowest incomes.
So I think his remarks.
We do have to change what we're doing, but we should be working together.
Member's
this
time
debate
is up.
Has been regrettable.
Thank you. I call the Minister for Communities, Mr. Paul Given, who will have up to 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to respond to the debate. Let me, from the outset, reassure members that my motivation to deal with housing issues is very much grounded on the experiences that I've had as an elected representative, from being a councillor in 2005, from the experiences that my colleagues have all had as a party that very much is grounded in the working class community. And it's not based on the opposition. It's not based on the opposition bringing a motion that we then decide to come up with an amendment within a couple of days that's going to increase that ambition. If the opposition believe that's how government operates, that's why they're in opposition. So I just want to make it clear what my motivation is. My motivation's based on being in Seymour Hill a number of weeks ago, seeing the damp and the conditions that people are having to live in terms of the tar blocks, the experience of being in a home when a young girl who was sadly paralysed in a wheelchair as a result of a car crash that her boyfriend had, and not getting the adaptations in her home put in place, the delays, the failure by the housing association responsible, and my intervention. It's based on when Nicola Mallon brings a constituent in to see me who, again, is struggling to get housed. That's what drives me when it comes to tackling housing. It's not based on the politics of responding to the opposition. So when Ms. Mallon talks about honeyed words isn't enough, you're not going to get honeyed words from me when it comes to dealing with the matters of housing. You're going to get hard work. But I would appeal to members, hysteria isn't going to achieve what we want to achieve. And what I've heard from some members of the official opposition has been more hysteria as opposed to real solutions. The most considered actual contributions from this debate from the opposition has came from two members who actually aren't in the official opposition, Ms. Long and Mr. Agnew, in terms of actually how we can go about dealing with this. So I appreciate and understand the need for the two official opposition parties to try and have relevancy. We certainly as a party want them to be relevant because we negotiated in opposition through the Fresh Start, so we want the opposition to work. But I think members should reflect on how they've added to this debate when it comes to dealing with what is a very important issue. So let me get to dealing with the issues that members have raised in terms of the substance around this, and hopefully I address most of the points members have brought to the floor, and I'll deal with some more specific ones, time permitting, Mr. Deputy Speaker. The motion allows me to recognise the success of previous ministers in exceeding the last programme for government's targets on social and affordable housing, and an opportunity to set out my ambition to do even more during the current programme for government period. Increasing housing supply across all tenures is an important issue. While the private house building industry continues its slow but steady recovery, it remains important for government to provide more than its fair share of new housing supply through additional social and affordable homes. Over the last 5 years, the executive, when the Ulster Unionist Party and the SDLP were in that government, and let me acknowledge that, did an excellent job as an executive in setting ourselves targets of starting 7,500 new social housing units. Not only did we meet that target, but we exceeded it, starting 7,669 new social homes over that period. There's a similar story on affordable housing, where we helped almost 4,700 households take the first step to owning their own homes against a target of 2,450. That success should rightly be recognised and applauded, and for that reason I'm going to be supporting Amendment number 2 from my own colleagues. I'm keen to build on that success and to do even more, particularly around social housing, during this current mandate. The Housing Executive has a statutory responsibility for assessing housing need and using the net stock model. It has identified a need to build 1,600 social homes per year to meet population change, and that does equate to 8,000 homes over the period 2016 to 2021. And I've already committed to building to this level as a minimum. However, I want to be even more ambitious than that, and as long as enough funding is available, I want to start 9,600 homes by March 2021. To achieve this, we will have to maximise the potential of the existing delivery system, and for this reason, I welcome the new delivery strategy developed by the Housing Executive in partnership with my department and the Federation of Housing Associations. As well as improving the way the Social Housing Development Programme operates, the strategy aims to increase the land bank available for social housing development and encourage housing associations to take on bigger sites. Amendment number 1 calls on me to ensure that the Housing Executive has powers to build social homes, and I can confirm that it already has these powers. However, the Housing Executive no longer builds for reasons of affordability. It could only build if its income from rent or other sources, such as house sales, allowed it to do so. The Housing Executive's current income falls short of what is needed to maintain its existing 88,000 properties, and I believe that's where the priority should first be. Also, it does not currently make financial sense for the Housing Executive to build homes. With their ability to borrow commercially, housing associations can deliver almost two houses for every one that the Housing Executive could deliver using grant alone. Ultimately, we need to... Yes, Mr. Beattie, I'll give way.
I thank the Minister for giving way. Can I ask the Minister if he has or would he engage with the Ministry of Defence, who have now scheduled their surplus housing stock in Aldergrove to be demolished next year, a housing stock that could be used for homeless veterans, families leaving the services in transition, or indeed yesterday having had a debate on domestic abuse as emergency housing for families involved in domestic abuse?
Well, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's an issue, of course, that the Executive did negotiate with Her Majesty's Government to have transfer of surplus properties, and a lot of that has came from the Ministry of Defence. I know in my own constituency there is surplus housing that is being provided, and that is an ongoing piece of programme that we're working on, but certainly the point is well made about making sure that when these properties become available that they're used. It does come with its challenges where there can be very significant amounts of houses released, and managing that process is one that a community at large needs to be able to do, and I'll touch on how we need broader support by community to be able to make the changes that we would want. The amendment in Amendment No. 1 also calls on me to suspend the house sales scheme, and my officials have just completed a policy review of that scheme, and I'll be considering options for the future of that scheme shortly. Whatever I decide, I'm keen to ensure that I support aspiration, helping those with the desire and the financial capability of moving into home ownership. I'm also mindful of the need to ensure that we have sufficient homes available for those who need to rent. It's right to be ambitious, but delivering 9,600 new social homes over the course of this mandate will not be easy. Money will never be endless. Land in areas of high need is in short supply, and we face community opposition to social housing development in some areas. Communities sometimes need that extra bit of reassurance, and I would welcome support as we look to build new homes right across Northern Ireland. As the motion recognises, affordable housing can also make an important contribution to meeting housing need and demand. My department has also been able to secure £100 million in government loan funding for co-ownership, and this helped support 725 families into home ownership last year. We have also extended the number of affordable housing products available through the Affordable Home Loans Fund, including a rent-to-own scheme. Taken together, all these initiatives will mean that I will aim to deliver 3,750 additional affordable homes over this mandate. I'll give way, yeah.
I appreciate the Minister giving way, seeing that he has already given away once during his response. The Minister will be aware that a number of members have asked for clarity around where the increased figures before us today have come from. Could the Minister please point us to where he has publicly announced this increased figure prior to today's debate, or will the Minister have the maturity and the honesty to admit that it is in response to the opposition motion before him today?
The member will know that, having met with me, and I note the change in tone when we're in the chamber compared to in a private environment when it comes to dealing with this issue, but this is an issue that we're dealing with. It's one throughout the programme for government. I've been engaging with my officials within the executive. It's a priority for us to be delivering more housing. If the member really believes that we come up with this figure in response to an opposition motion, that is not how government works. Mr. Atwood, who is very familiar with the needs of providing housing, will know you simply would not be able to provide these figures in response to a motion. whenever you have to go through the processes of engaging with officials, with housing associations, the housing executive, so that you can provide a credible figure that you can stand over. It isn't simply, as Mr. Atwood, I think, did indicate, raise me higher, who's got the best cards. That's not how politics works. It's not how the delivery of housing works. I will, Mr. Atwood.
Would you at least concede that it is a curious coincidence that the figures being proposed by the SDLP over 4 years are in and around the figures that you now propose over five?
Curious indeed, Mr. Atwood. Mr. Humphrey, I think, was wanting to give away.
Would the Minister agree with me that sometimes there's a difficulty with the Housing Executive in terms of their role and responsibility about regeneration? And therefore, would the Minister agree with me, having visited the Building Successful Community areas in North and West Belfast with me only a few weeks ago, that that is a really good pilot and a good example of how can we rolled out across Northern Ireland of, for example, Lower Lowell Park, where there are 26 derelict homes that have been brought back to life. The confidence in the competency committee has increased. The environment has massively improved. Now we have 10 houses being built in the front of the Old Park Road, with 15 affordable being planned for Clifton Park Avenue. That is an example of how the executive can work when it is supported by the department, working in a joint-up approach that the Minister talked about earlier in his speech.
Order. Remind members that interventions ought to be short and concise. Minister, you're losing time.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Certainly the visit that I did have demonstrated to me the importance of that particular programme. One of the arguments I know that had been made by previous ministers, whenever it was in the DUP who held this, about there not being need whilst areas were allowed to continue into dereliction. And of course, who wants to move into areas whenever you're not improving that environment? The DUP, having implemented this new programme, have regenerated a number of these areas, particularly in North Belfast, and now you have people on waiting lists wanting to get into these areas, and that's been as a result of DUP ministers implementing that and the representation made by none least than Mr. Humphrey. So in respect of how we can take this forward, I want to do more. And let me just finish, Deputy Speaker, in highlighting another area. The department is responsible for St Patrick's barracks site in Ballymena, and we're developing plans which include the provision of social, affordable and private housing, all with a shared housing ethos. And I know Ms Long isn't here presently when she touched on this issue about previous comments that I had made. Let me be very clear. I support shared housing. But it's about creating the conditions and the environment where people want to share housing. It is not about forcing people, and it's not about manipulating a waiting list to deprive people who need a house on the basis of their religion. I'm very clear on how I want to see shared housing developed. So I'm keen to see a more mixed tenure housing of this type, and I've asked my officials to develop proposals for how this could be achieved, potentially using money within the Fresh Start Agreement earmarked for shared housing. Building new housing is clearly important, but housing need can also be met in other important ways. The private rented sector has a role to play, and later this year I'll be publishing proposals for consultation on the future role and regulation of the private rented sector. Preventing homelessness is also of critical importance. This year I'm investing almost £1 million in housing advice services to help over 7,000 households take action on serious housing issues and directly prevent homelessness in almost 500 cases. The Housing Executive is also rolling out a housing option service across its office network. This aims to provide a more holistic service to those with housing issues and take early action to prevent homelessness. Where possible, prevention is always better than cure, and I'm also investing funding through supporting people and the homelessness strategy in helping to end the cycle of homelessness for those who have found themselves homeless on a regular basis, including on the streets. And I've seen some of this work firsthand, and it does help people turn their lives around. In conclusion, increasing the supply of housing across all tenures is a vital issue. I'll do all that I can to increase the supply of social and affordable housing, but I can't do this alone. I need the support of all in this chamber to encourage local communities to embrace the opportunities new development brings. I need the support of councils to zone enough land for housing and deliver a high-quality planning service. It won't be easy, but I want to be ambitious and for all in this chamber to share this ambition and help deliver significant numbers of social and affordable homes over this mandate. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. Order. Always a pleasure to see people in the public gallery. It's a particular pleasure for me today to welcome the principal, staff and pupils of Bessbrook Primary School to the public gallery. All politics local. I call Mr. Christopher Stalford to wind.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I would like to associate myself firstly, Mr. Deputy Speaker, with the comments that the Minister made regarding the contributions that we heard from the Member for North Down, Mr. Agnew, and the Member for East Belfast, Mrs. Long. Whilst I didn't agree with everything that both of them said, I thought that they were measured and sensible contributions that had useful ideas in them. Like the Minister, I spent a long time in local government, 11 years in fact, and like the Minister, I have long experience of dealing with constituents who have encountered all sorts of difficulties, whether presenting as homeless, seeking improvements or adaptations to their properties. We have all of us, or at least if we're doing our job properly, all of us have had experience of that, of constituents who are plagued in damp-ridden properties, of people who are waiting for a long, long time to get into housing. Like the member for North Belfast, I agree that a home is a fundamental right. Stable and secure communities, stable and secure families, a stable and secure society is reliant upon a supply of housing that is of a high standard. I think there was a recent survey that showed that 40% of housing in the mainland was insufficient in terms of the quality of housing being provided. I don't think that the figure is comparable for Northern Ireland. But there is a huge problem, not only in terms of the need for new builds, but also in terms of the need for improvement and adaptation of existing properties. House building is important, and it is an important question to ask in this debate. The simple question is it better to build 9,600 social units, or is it better to build 8,800? If the answer is that it's better to build 9,600 than it is to build 8,800, then people should support the amendment that we have tabled. I think it's unfortunate that some of the broad agreement that I think there is, and Mr. Agnew referenced this, some of the broad agreement that there is on these issues and the need for action in these areas has been drowned out by some of the contributions in the debate. But I think that's perhaps all will be well when we get back into the committee and have further discussions on these issues, because I think sitting on the Communities Committee as I do, there is agreement across all parties of the need for action in these areas. So if there's a bit of knockabout in here, that's the nature of the game, and people will see that for what it is. I agree with the Minister as well. The notion that a motion tabled by the opposition would in some way direct a government minister to change his housing target is laughable. And I think they know that. When they stand up and say those things, I think they know that. The proposal that came from the opposition did show a lack of ambition. And I'm glad that the government is going further than the opposition hoped to. And so therefore, I welcome the chance to discuss that. Mention was made in terms of the debate with regard to outcomes-based accountability. I welcome the shift to outcomes-based government. I think that's a really positive route to go down. I think that as a government, we should be judged at the end of our 5 years as to the targets that we set and whether or not we meet them. And I'm happy that the target that we're setting in relation to house building is an ambitious one that goes further than the opposition had suggested. And I hope that at the end of our five-year term, we will have delivered on it. And people will be able to look at the end of, like a scorecard, like a report card. People will be able to look and see that we met that target. I disagree with the idea of ending the right to buy scheme. The right of people to own their own home should be encouraged. We should encourage people who wish to get onto the property ladder if they so want to do. I believe in the right of people to own their home and not to live their lives as clients of the state, paying the state rent, and upon their death having... Yes, I will.
Just obviously on the right to buy. And I think over many years that, the, and I have no doubt that it was a popular scheme, but when you look back at the impact, the destructive impact that it has on the social housing stock, then you can only come to the realisation that you need to seize it. In Scotland...
Ask the member to be brief.
Scotland had done a review and changed it. In Wales, they've done a review and changed it. And it has to be the way forward for us. And it'd be interesting to listen to the Minister's review when it's...
Order. Can I ask Mr Stalford to address that immediately, because I can't award you an extra minute.
Okay, I'll be very brief on that. I believe in a mixed housing market. I don't believe that the state should be the sole provider of housing. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr Raymond McCartney to wind on amendment number
one. I'll ask one caller. We won't be supporting the motion. We have listened to, obviously, the Minister's contribution this morning, which we welcome, and certainly the contributions from the DUP. So we will be supporting their amendment and not calling a division on our own amendment. I think one of the striking aspects of the motion today is that you get this sort of sense that from the SDLP and the Ulster Unionists that they somehow believe that once they opted out and the opposition, that somehow that all that went before didn't exist, that as if that there was no time before a certain date. And for them, it's sometime in June 2016 where you had day one, year zero. But I don't get an extra minute, so the answer is no. However, the reality is that no matter how hard they tried or no matter how many times they said, then other people will remind them of positions which they have taken in particular issues. So even today, they look at today's motion. Today's motion states that by 2021, there should be 11,700 new homes, a breakup of 8,800 social and 2,900 affordable homes. Now, we received no explanation or rationale as to why they come to these particular figures, and I suppose the secret lies in what they have recently said. The Ulster Unionists, in their election manifesto of 2016 May, just a few short months ago, talked about the need to build 10,000 new social homes by 2021. There's no reference to that figure or how they got it, but it's premised on a waiting list of 44,000 on the waiting list. So the motion today is actually, a lower total on the waiting list. We're even told now because, well, we're not sure if it's an SDLP motion or an opposition motion from the point of order, but we're told that now in a lesser timescale, they actually want to build more houses than their target in May and provide no opposition. The only thing that has changed is that they are now in opposition. They think you can say whatever you want, and that sounds good. The SDLP, and they did hold the housing portfolio, so I think with the benefit of the inside track, so to speak, you'd think that their figure would be worth noting. But when you look at their assembly manifesto, no real figure, no approximate, a very vague and indeed clever reference to the regional development strategy, talk about the need to increase provision, no reference, no baseline. But now in October 2016, a very, very precise figure. This world of opposition is a very wonderful place. Nicola Mallon, when she was speaking, talked about the need, the great need, in North Belfast, and Colm Eastwood, who's to be congratulated for perhaps the most impromptu speech he ever had to make. Someone who has their name down for a motion, actually saying, I didn't know it was going to be called to speak, is some admission in itself. But he did go on to say that there was also great need in North Belfast, West Belfast, and indeed his own constituency, my constituency of Derry. There once was ring fencing for social housing in those three areas because of the need, and it was well identified. Framachan pointed out that many, many people thought that was a sensible approach. Where there's great need, go after it. That scheme was brought to an end by the SDLP, initiated by Margaret Ritchie, and then processed through by Alec Atwood, in case Colm feels left out. He was the Under-Secretary at the time. So for us, it's a very, very clear statement. We are part of the programme for government. In our manifesto, we set a minimum of 10,000 social homes. That's what we will be tested on. That's what the programme for government, that's what setting outcomes will do. We will be tested on what we say. And I think it is very, very important, you know, for both the SDLP and the Ulster Unionists to learn this about opposition. You know, they remind me of the story of the person who grafted a hump onto a horse and started to call it a camel and expected everybody else to believe it was a camel. Well, when you bring a motion to this House, it will be tested, it will be scrutinised, and what you have said in the past, you will be reminded of, and we will certainly call your camel a horse because it is a horse. Go on, my last one, please.
Order. Thank you. I call Jenny Palmer to conclude and wind up the debate on the substantive motion.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And can I say at the outset that I welcome the Minister's intention to give the undertaking that they will build more new houses in this term. I also, Mr. Speaker, want to raise some of the issues. Although the causes and the solutions to the issue that this motion grapples with are complex, the issue itself is simple. There is a desperate need to increase housing supply. There's not one person in here that would disagree with that statement. Every day, in every constituency office, amongst us all, there are people in desperate need of housing and housing needs. And so we have families where they have no homes, where they don't feel as though their children could be raised in the sense of giving them a normal societal settlement. And the lack of supply is having dire impacts on their health and their education and causing social problems. And I thank Nicola Mallon for contributing to the debate in terms of her voice in raising that issue. There is only one way to address this problem. We must build more homes. We must increase capacity for the many thousands in housing stress. At the moment, we are simply delivering too few new developments, and the slow pace of public land release, coupled with the inflexibility of needs assessment, means that we often build 10 homes when we need 100 homes. Northern Ireland's status as a low-wage economy complicates this issue. The recent scandal of the much-lauded government-supported help-to-buy ISA scheme, which provided very little help to buy due to a fatal flaw with the bonus, only exasperates the situation. The increasing private rental costs and shortfalls in housing benefit all combine into a perfect storm to maximise housing need. Once again, it seems like the bank of mum and dad must rescue young families hoping to buy their homes or to pay the rental needs. This is not an acceptable position. When we also consider the prevalence of one-year tenancy agreements, it's hardly surprising that so many feel that their house is not their home. There is a need for innovation in housing supply, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. We need more one-bedroom flats for older people. We need more two-bed houses with expandability. Again, the inflexible needs analysis needs to be modernised. Why can't Northern Ireland lead the way in exploring smart home technology that reduces crime, that delivers energy-efficient outcomes and adapts to the needs of the families and the disabled? Housing should be the backbone of local regeneration. It can be the catalyst to support inward investment in construction, infrastructure, employment and build communities. Now is the time to look at the potential of pension schemes to finance future housing programmes. I know that Nicola Mallon highlighted in her address the cry from some of the members on the left of the DUP where there were financial constraints. And certainly, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, there was certainly no financial difficulty in squandering over £1 billion on the renewable heating incentive. Just imagine how many new homes that might have built. Perhaps the Minister can update the House on the progress of the long-awaited review of the Housing Executive.
Answer yesterday, a written answer to myself on the renewable scheme, which says that the anticipated cost in the upcoming year is £37 million.
I thank you for that intervention. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, if you'll forgive me for being a little bit parochial for one moment, as did the Minister, I would like to talk to the Minister as a fellow Lygon Valley representative. Minister, in our own constituency, there are 988 people in housing stress. There are currently 159 social houses being built in the Lygon Valley. We must build more for the sake of those 829 people and for many, many more across the province. And Frau McCann, he gave us figures of 22,654 in housing stress. So that just shows the level of importance that housing is in this debate. Minister, housing is a plural, and you have the opportunity to give a massive boost if you are bold and brave enough to embrace new solutions and support people and offers them a home. I want to thank Alex Atwood. Alex Atwood certainly put to bed the nonsense about statistics and damn statistics across this chamber. Everyone had their statistics to suit themselves, but the statistics here are as Alex Atwood had alluded to. Yes, we can all play games around statistics. And I want to pay tribute to my colleague here, Andy Allen, who took some abuse there from the left of the chamber, to my left anyway, took some abuse, and actually it was pretty hot at times, but he held his own in determining that he works solidly in social housing in his constituency, and I admire that for a man who has had the disability that he suffers from, that he challenges disability and social and affordable housing in his constituency. I want to remind Mr. Bale of the figures that are currently being debated in this chamber. That it was 2007 to 2011. That was for a four-year term, and the 2011-2016 is for the five-year term. So the anomaly, you can work it all out yourselves, but I don't want to get fixated on figures. I just want that we get a debate here today that is sensible about how we move forward, about the importance of delivering new solutions to housing in Northern Ireland. And the Minister did say that the Northern Ireland Housing Executive has the right and has the power to build, but unfortunately, at the time of the existence of the Housing Executive, I will in a second, unfortunately, when the Housing Executive at the very beginning was funded fully from the public purse, and the decision was taken that the Housing Executive would not then be able to avail of full housing funding. So there is an opportunity here, Minister, in terms of splitting the Housing Executive into two entities, one to become one of the largest housing associations, deshackle them from the with the housing associations as we move forward, and I believe it is the Office of National Statistics that is setting the scene in terms of where the housing association movement will be. Why not deshackle the Housing Executive as well and allow them to bid as like anyone else in terms of the new build programme, and actually reduce the hag and make it more competitive for all developers to challenge for to build new and affordable social housing? And I bet you any money that social housing will be built at a far better price. Happy to give way.
I thought I'd moved down to the SDLP there. And, you know, your last statement is very correct. I think that whilst the Housing Executive retains the right to build, the lack of capital or financial resources means that it can't, but it could be a game changer. The other thing, and I know we're all talking about statistics this morning, but I said in the speech is behind the statistics are faces of families, of young people, of children in hostels and overcrowded homes, and that's why we should never lose the fact that this is happening. It's faces, not statistics, that we should be dealing with.
I hear what you're saying, and I also hear that the the Northern Ireland Housing Executive themselves, with an 88,000 stock, and one of the biggest commercial small portfolios of small business portfolios, actually would have the capacity to borrow on the strength of that, had the shackles been removed, and allow them to become their own independent housing association as a charity, just like all of the other housing associations. But you know, it's all in the detail, and it's for the Minister to solve that detail and to try to deliver far, far better housing for Northern Ireland. And I welcome the motion today.
Before I put the question on amendment, on amendment number one, I would remind members that if amendment number one is made, I will not put the question on amendment number two. The question is that amendment number one, standing in the names of Fran McCann, Carl McCullen and Michelle Gildernew, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have it. The noes have it. The question is that amendment number two, standing in the names of Mr. Jonathan Bell, Adrian McQuillan and Christopher Stalford, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it.